I'm not match, and there's no one to go. Heart under attack, no hope on my own. I pray and I tear, spin out of control. The burdens I wear, the weights on my shoulders. So find me here as I surrender. I need you to do what only you can. Only you can fight for my life when fear's got me surrounded. Only you can. Only you can keep me believing when doubt's got me drowning. 'Cause there's no one else that can calm this storm. There's no one else that can tame my soul. Only you can. Only you can. Only you can. When all that I face is face to face with your power, the enemy's silence as my praise get louder. The battle's been won, the darkness will hide. The things in me, I'll shout and rise. So find me here and I surrender. Oh, I need you to do what only you can. Only you can fight for my life when fear's got me surrounded. Only you can. Only you can keep me believing when doubts got me drowning. 'Cause there's no one else that can calm this storm. And there's no one else that can save my soul. Only you can. Only you can. God, only you can. I lift my hands up to the only unstoppable King. The one who can see far beyond the things that I see. And in the moments that I've lost the strength to believe, I won't give up on the only one who won't give up on me. I lift my hands up to the only unstoppable King. The one who can see far beyond the things that I see. And in the moments when I've lost the strength to believe, I won't give up on the only one who won't give up on me. Lord, find me here as I surrender. Fight for my life when fear's got me surrounded. Only you can. Only you can keep me believing when doubt's got me drowning. 'Cause there's no one else that can calm this storm. There's no one else that can save my soul. Only you can. Only you can. Yeah. Only you can.
Days I've seen hope rise up from a broken place. Yeah, it always blows my mind when the water turns to wine. He does what only he can do. Ain't it like Jesus to flip the situation? Ain't it like Jesus? Zero limitations. There's nothing that he cannot do. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Watch him take it all and make it new. Ain't it like Jesus is in the nick of time, changing up the paradigm? Ain't it like Jesus? Ain't it like Jesus? When I'm miles from shore, I'll be singing praise. 'Cause I know the only voice that calms the waves. Yeah, it always blows my mind how he opens blinded eyes. He does what only he can do. Ain't it like Jesus? Flip the situation. Ain't it like Jesus? Zero limitations. Thank you.
Morning. Great to see you this morning. We're so glad you're here and excited to worship with you on this Vision Sunday as we get to talk about the vision of our church and what God is calling us to. So thank you for being here this morning. If you're a visitor with us, welcome to Grace. We have a connection booth in the foyer. If you haven't had a chance to stop by, we'd love to meet you there. We have a gift to send home with you as well, so be sure to check it out. Before we get to our Grace news, one quick, if you missed your chance to get a picture at the photo booth, it is still up for this last Sunday. Still up downstairs, so if you want to get a family photo, a late Christmas, maybe get a jump on your Christmas card for next year, just have someone stand in front of the year on the sign there. And anyway, it's still up today, and we're going to take it down this week. So that is there for you. With that, let's roll our Grace News. Hey, parents of middle schoolers and high schoolers. Today, right after second service, we have our Fearless Lunch and Information meeting. So come on down to the Fellowship Hall right after second service, right about 12:15. We'll start lunch. We want to give you an opportunity to connect with our youth leaders, as well as give you some information for what is coming up here in 2023 for our youth ministry. And you get to hear about our summer mission trip as well. So please join us right after church today.
January 15th is our next Lord's Supper and family meal. This is a great time for us to come together as a church, to share a meal, to take communion together, to be encouraged in a devotional and have some time of worship. So make sure that you sign up through the Church Center app. We'd love to see you there January 15th.
Thank you so much for joining us this weekend. We are so glad to have you. Just a couple reminders, if you want to text in a question about anything we talked about today, there will be a telephone number on the screen during the sermon. It's an anonymous text line, so feel free to text any question in, and each week on our Weekend Debrief podcast, we'll be answering those questions. Also, if you want to contribute to the ministries of Grace Church, you can use the giving envelope and put them in the donation boxes on your way out. We also have online giving, and you can also give to the Church Center app. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
Morning. Let's stand together as we get to begin to start off by singing this song, "In a Marvelous Light I'm Running, Out of Darkness, Out of Shame," that we come to Jesus, that he wipes all of our past away, that we can come before him now and run into the light, that we don't have to be afraid of our sin, that Jesus has paid for that. And so we want to sing that out this morning. Let's sing.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross, you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. I once was fatherless, a stranger. dead heart now is me. My deepest stakes now clean. Your breath fills up. Death has lost its sting. From your grave you risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running. Out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. Sinners lost its power. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you risen victoriously. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running. Out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the light. You are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running. Out of darkness, out. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the life, you are the way. You are the way.
Yeah, we thank you, Lord, that, again, you are here, you're moving in this place, and so as we continue to come into your presence, God, we worship you, that you are a way maker, you're a miracle worker, a promise keeper. We trust in your promises today.
That is who you are. That is who. never stop working, never stop, never stop working. Cause even when I'm scared you're working, even when I'm scared you're working, never stop, never stop. Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Lord, again, we just worship you today. We want to hear from you, from your word. God, it's so good to gather together as your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go ahead and have a seat.
Amen. Good morning. Welcome to those joining us online or live stream as well. It's 2023, and as we enter this new year, we want to make sure that we are lifting others up before the Lord in prayer. One of the ways that we do that from month to month is by introducing you to some of the churches we're networked with in Harbor Network, the church planning and church health network that we're a part of, and then praying for those churches. And so we try to do about two churches a month and lift their pastors, their pastors' families, and their churches before the Lord. And so today we've got two different churches, one in Chattanooga, Tennessee. That's Sojourn Community Church, pastors Isaiah and Elizabeth Lewis, and then John and Jenna Stark, and they pastor in New York City, Apostles Church Uptown. And so we'll start with the Lewis family. My wife and I actually got to connect with them and meet them at the Harbor Network Leadership Summit back in October. And just a great couple, really hit it off with them. And he was so encouraged when I reached out to ask how we could be praying for them. And he sent some requests for their church. First, that God would increase their stewardship across the board for their members, regular attenders, that their people would sacrificially and faithfully give to support the their church budget and their ministries. Secondly, that God would draw the hearts of their people to Him, specifically through personal and corporate prayer. They're starting today a new series on the Lord's Prayer, and he is really hoping and praying that God will use it to generate a culture of prayer in their church. And then that God would lead them as they evaluate how they develop and train leaders in their church. And then finally, for their women's discipleship ministry, Liz, his wife Elizabeth, she is going to be starting a women's Bible study in February. And so as she prepares for that, and as they invite ladies to that, they ask for prayer that it would just be fruitful in their church. A little side story, they are fairly new to their church within the last year, I believe. And so really starting to try to get things moving in their church and that kind of thing. For their city, they ask for prayer for the legalistic and cultural Christianity, that it would be unmasked as empty and worthless, for gospel-centered churches to flourish and encourage one another. So not just having church there, but churches that really are, embrace the gospel and are centered on the gospel. And then for their family, for this couple, prayer against discouragement and the attacks of the enemy, and for hopeful and patient joy. For consistent time together in prayer and walking with one another towards Jesus, and that they would love one another and others well through the many complications and challenges of ministry life, faithfully giving grace-filled truth and truthful grace with joy and patience. And that would be a prayer for all of us, huh? So that's Isaiah and Elizabeth Lewis at Sojourn Community Church in Chattanooga. And then John and Jenna Stark, you can imagine the hostility they face pastoring in New York City. And so he asked for prayer for their church. He says that they are focusing on the theme of being an exile in 1 Peter starting in January. And so he would love for prayer for their church, which tends to be more on the younger side, to mature towards a faith that perseveres in cultural exile, and even in seasons of suffering. And then for their family, they have four kids, and he asked for prayer specifically for their two middle children. They're going through the baptism process of their church. They express faith, and they're hoping to baptize them in the new year and this year. And so pray for their faith and a long life being joined with Jesus. What an exciting thing for that family. So let's lift up these two churches, these two pastors and families before the Lord, and remember them in prayer this next week. God, we thank you so much for the blessing of being partnered with like-minded churches across our country. We thank you, Lord, for the encouragement that they are, for the ministry you are doing in and through these churches in Tennessee and New York. And Lord, we pray that you would be working in the lives of Isaiah and Elizabeth. We thank you, Lord, for their commitment to one another, their desire to be hopeful and be filled with joy and patience. We pray, Lord, that they would be consistent in their time of prayer with each other, and that they would be able to speak grace-filled truth and truth-filled grace with joy and patience. Lord, that you would help their church to financially be stable, that you would increase the faithfulness of their regular attenders and members in giving. Lord, we also pray that they would be able to foster a culture of prayer in their church through this new series that they kick off today. We thank you, Lord, for the desire to being a praying church. We also pray, Lord, that you would help them develop leaders with wisdom, and they would be able to strengthen their process of finding and training, deploying new leaders. And for this new women's Bible study that Elizabeth is going to be starting in February, we pray, Lord, the right ladies would come. We pray for her preparation, Lord, that this would be used to disciple many women in their church and community. Lord, I also pray for John and Jenna Stark. We praise you for their children coming to know you and wanting to express that through baptism. We pray that as they go through the process, Lord, that they would be encouraged and strengthened. Lord, that they would have a lifelong faith and would have much joy in serving you with their whole lives. We also pray, Lord, for their church as they focus on the theme of exile in 1 Peter. And as they face opposition, I'm sure, and suffering and exile in their city, Lord, we pray that they would be a bright shining light for you, and that they would be strong and persevere, and that their younger believers would be matured through the teaching. Lord, we thank you so much for the Stark family and the Lewis family, for Apostles Church and Sojourn Community Church. We pray, Lord, that this would be a year of blessing for them, that next year they would have much to celebrate because of what you have done in and through them. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. We now stand as we get ready to read God's word together. We are going to have Elizabeth come up and read to us from the book of Matthew.
Good morning. This morning's reading is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. 11 disciples traveled to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped, but some doubted. Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Will you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you so much for our ability to be able to gather together and to pray with one another and to worship you without threat of persecution or harm. We pray for people all over the world who are worshiping you today, Lord, and may be facing difficulties. We thank you, Lord, that you came and that you are with us always and will never leave us. I ask you to be with Dave as he comes forward to give us your word. Please open our hearts, open our ears, open our minds to receive what it is you have to tell us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Elizabeth. You may be seated. If you're already open to Matthew 28, go ahead and stay there. If you haven't turned there yet, you can go ahead and do that. It's the first book in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We're in Matthew 28, the final chapter of the book of Matthew. I don't know about you, but the transition from December to January every year is a tough one. I love December. I love the whole Christmas season, all the carols and lights and the trees and the food and family time and all the things that go into celebrating Christmas. My birthday is in December, which always is a fun thing to celebrate me. And then we get to January, and then we get to January, and that transition is so stark because you go from food and celebration and fun, hopefully, family and all of these things, and then we get to January 1, and what happens? We start making resolutions and goals, and we start trying to improve ourselves and shed the pounds that we packed on during November and December with all our celebrating and those things, right? 'Tis the season to be jolly gives way to the season where we need to get jogging. I worked on that line. Thank you for laughing. I appreciate that. And so we have to start really focusing on goals, resolutions, improvements. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. And while it can be really hard, it also can be really good. We need those moments in our lives where we can stop and refocus, restart, realign, where we can look back at the year we came out of and celebrate some things, but also look at some things that we want to improve. And now we have a reason to start trying to improve those things, right? And what helps is knowing what you're trying to accomplish, having a goal in mind that you're trying to hit. I think of that classic Zig Ziglar quote, if you aim nothing, you will hit it every time. And so we need to know what we are aiming at so that we can actually hit a target and not just go any which direction and not actually accomplish anything. And so we set goals, resolutions, or we were kind of joking around in our staff meeting this last week because I was going around and asking for people's goals for the year. And some of their goals were that they weren't going to have goals this year. What a lofty goal to not have goals. So whatever you call them, goals, resolutions, guidelines, life hacks, lifestyles, a path forward, however you want to call them, where are you going this year? Here are some of my goals I'll share with our staff. Less sugar, more exercise this year. Read more, watch less. I want to read, my goal is to read 42 books this year. That's because that's my, as I add up all the books that I've set aside to read and need to read in the coming months, it totaled 42. So there you go. I'm going to try to read 42 books this year. I want to have regular time, personal time with the Lord. I got pretty lax with that last year, and so I want to be more disciplined and have more time in God's word and prayer. And then I want to disciple my family well. I mean, I've had some good talks about how we can, and specifically, I can improve in discipling girls to know and love the Lord and to model that for them. So those are some of my goals for the year. What about you? Take 30 seconds, turn to your neighbor, preferably not your spouse, and share one goal, or if you're not into goals or resolutions, one guideline or life hack or lifestyle choice or whatever you want to call it. Share something you want to see change this year. Share it with your neighbor right now. 30 seconds. Go. All right, here's what I want you to do. Grab a connection card, write down what they told you, and then next year, no, just kidding. Just as it's good for us to have personal goals, things we're striving for, things that we want to improve this next year, it's also good for churches to think through these things. What are our goals for our church in the coming year? And when we think about these things, we don't want to just come up with ideas on our own. Instead, we want to turn to the leader of the church. And that's not me. That's not our other team, even though we are involved in helping to lead. But that's turning to Jesus. He is the senior pastor of the big church and our church. But that's a whole nother topic we could spend a whole sermon talking about. We want to look to Jesus and have him tell us what he wants for our church this year. And so we're going to do that by looking at Matthew 28, the verses we just read. Because Jesus so clearly articulates what he wants his people to be about in this passage. And what we're going to find is this: the church is to be a community of disciples, making disciples in our community. The church is to be a community of disciples, making disciples in our community. Before we get into our text, it's important for us to define what we mean by disciple. Jesus says, verse 19, go and make disciples. We are to be disciples of Jesus. So what does that mean, to be a disciple? In fact, in this passage, the clear command of Jesus is to make disciples. It's not to go. We make disciples as we go. It's not to baptize. We baptize those who've been made disciples. We'll talk about that in a minute. The command, though, is make disciples. So what does it mean to make disciples? That's why I like this title screen, Follow Me, Disciples Making Disciples. To follow Jesus really is the heart of what it means to be a disciple, to follow Jesus. It does seem a bit vague, though, right? And so can we get more specific? I like the words of John Mark Comer in his book, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, where he says this: to be one of Jesus's Talmudim, that's the Hebrew word for disciple, is to apprentice under Jesus. Put simply, it's to organize your life around three basic goals: be with Jesus, become like Jesus, do what he would do if he were you. Be with Jesus, become like Jesus, do what he would do if he were you. And then he goes on, the whole point of apprenticeship is to model all of your life after Jesus. That's what it means to be a disciple. I love that theme of apprenticeship. Doesn't that bring clarity? If you apprentice under someone, you model yourself after that person. You learn from them, you spend time with them, you observe them, you train with them, you let them teach you. So be with Jesus, become like Jesus, do what he would do if he were you. Model your whole life, all of your life, after Jesus. So that's what it means to be a disciple. If we as disciples of Jesus, which is the term in the New Testament for Christ followers, disciples. In fact, the word Christian isn't used until later in the book of Acts, and it's more of a derogatory term initially. So to be a disciple is what it means to be a follower of Christ. If we're to model our lives after Jesus, then we're also to go out and make disciples, help others know who Jesus is and model their lives after Jesus. And because it's such an important theme in Scripture, and specifically in this passage that we call the Great Commission, Jesus' commissioning of his people before he leaves the earth, that's what we have made the mission statement of our church: worshiping God by making disciples. So, what are the specific characteristics of being a disciple? There are many different characteristics. We're going to narrow it down to five. You probably already know what those five are because they're on banners up front. We talk about these things all the time. But if we are going to set the stage, we're going to set goals for this coming year, what better way than to hear from Jesus how we can do these things? And really what this passage tells us is that we are to worship, connect, grow, serve, and reproduce. So the first thing, disciples are to worship Jesus. Disciples are to worship Jesus. This first one's a little bit tricky, specifically coming from Matthew 28, because there's no command to worship Jesus found here. However, we can observe the response of the original disciples in this passage, and we can also see worship as implication of what Jesus tells us about himself in this passage. Here's what I mean. Let's look at verse 16 again. The 11 disciples traveled to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped, though some doubted. So we see these 11 disciples, 11 because Judas betrayed Jesus. He's no longer with them. So the 12 disciples are now down to 11. And they come to a mountain in Galilee as Jesus directed them. So we see here that the disciples are obeying what Jesus had told them to do. He had told them, go meet me in Galilee. And we know that by some verses earlier in this chapter. If we go back to verse 9, we see that there were some women who were the first to go and see the empty tomb. Remember the women, they were going to go and wrap Jesus' body and all those things. But the tomb was open and empty and there was an angel there. And then after that, it says in verse 9, that just then Jesus met them. So they've seen the empty tomb, they've seen the angels, but then Jesus met them and said, greetings. They came up, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus told them, do not be afraid, go and tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there. So Jesus tells these women, hey, go tell my brothers, tell the other disciples to go to Galilee. I will meet them there. The disciples obediently go to Galilee, and Jesus comes and meets them there. So these disciples are obeying what Jesus said. That in and of itself is a form of worship. They're doing what Jesus commanded them to do. But then when Jesus shows up, it says that many of them fall down and begin to worship him. They worship, but there's also some, it says, who doubt. Now, this word that is translated in my translation, doubt, that's a little strong for the word that's in the original language. A better word, some have suggested, would be hesitated, but some hesitated. We often pit faith and doubt against each other, right? But this is more of a hesitation, an uncertainty. Now, it could be that some of the 11 disciples hesitated. They weren't sure, is that really Jesus? Maybe he was off in a distance. And some just immediately were like, that's Jesus, and start worshiping. And others hesitated. That could be. It also could be that there are more people here than just the 11 disciples, but they're just not mentioned in this context. But we know that there were up to 500 at one point who saw Jesus after the resurrection. So could there have been more people here, but the focus is on the 11? Sure. So in that case, maybe some of the other people who were there were the ones who hesitated. Either way, here's the point. There were some who fell down and worshipped him and were ready to go right then. And there were others who were not yet quite ready. They hesitated. There was a moment of question. And that's probably true of all of us. There are some of you who are, I'm in 100%, I'm on board, let's go take the mountain for Jesus. And then there's others of you who are a little bit hesitant, still trying to figure things out. You've got questions. But here's the thing. Jesus calls all of those people, all of us, whether you're ready or whether you're hesitant, he calls us to the mission that he has for us, regardless of how we respond to him. But what you need to know is this, whether you're ready or whether you're hesitant, Jesus is alive and he's worthy of your worship and allegiance. And Jesus is ready to use you, even if you might be a little hesitant to be used by Jesus. So we see that these disciples worship, showing us what proper response to Jesus would be. But there's another reason why I think we see worship in this passage. And that's what comes next in verse 18. Jesus came near and said to them, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. All authority. Jesus defines what all authority means in heaven and on earth. You remember in the fall, if you were here with us in the fall, we went through the first 11 chapters of the book of Genesis. We saw the opening words of Genesis in the beginning. God created the heavens and the earth. What do we say was meant by the heavens and the earth? It's like saying top to bottom, meaning everything up here, everything down here, and everything in between. It's a way to describe everything. Everything that's out there, everything down here was all created by God. And in the same way, Jesus is saying that's where he has authority. In the heavens and on the earth, Jesus has authority everywhere. And so the one who has authority everywhere is king of the entire universe. And as king, he is worthy of our worship, our allegiance. We follow him because he is the one who is worthy. He's worthy because of who he is. He's also worthy because of what he has done, going to the cross for us. That's what we see in Philippians chapter 2, where the Apostle Paul unpacks this beautiful theme of servanthood of Jesus, that he is God who became a man, but not a man that wanted to rule over the world, but instead he came as a servant and even submitted himself to death on a cross. And then he says in Philippians 2:9, for this reason, because of what he has said about Jesus, that he is God who became man, who submitted himself to the cross to serve us. For this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Where? Here it is again. In heaven and on earth and under the earth. So every being everywhere will one day bow their knee to Jesus. Verse 11, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. What is the proper response to the one who is ruling over everything? It's to worship. It's to submit yourself to them. It's to obey what they ask of you. Jesus is King and Lord over all things. Have you recognized this? He's Lord over this universe, this world, your family, your life. Is your response to bow down and worship him, to submit yourself to him? He is worthy of our worship because of who he is and because of what he has done. He's our king, and as our king, he sends us on a mission, which is the second thing that we see here. Disciples are to reproduce disciples. Disciples are to reproduce disciples. So they're to worship Jesus, and one of the ways that they worship Jesus is to reproduce disciples. So all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Go, therefore. We've said this before. One of the keys to Bible study is knowing what certain words are trying to tell you. And so when you read therefore, you should ask, what is the therefore, therefore? The therefore is to tell you that what Jesus is about to say is dependent upon what he has just said. That because he has all authority, now he is using that authority to command his followers. And what does he tell them to do? Go and make disciples of all nations. Jesus has all the authority, and with that authority, he sends his people out. We don't do it because it's easy. We don't do it because it's what we've always done. We do it because Jesus is King and has told us to do it. We are to go and make disciples. And as we respond in obedience and make disciples, as Jesus has told us, as we submit ourselves to his authority, we worship him. This is why we describe our mission as a church in this way, worshiping God by making disciples. We don't say worshiping God and making disciples. These are not two separate things. We worship God and we also make disciples. No, they are connected. We worship God by making disciples, by being obedient to his commands as the king over the entire universe. And that's something we want to be better at as a church this year. Making disciples, reproducing disciples. Because hasn't it felt a little bit like we've just been focused on surviving? As a nation, as a church, as families, as individuals. Doesn't it feel like we're just trying to get by? And for good reason. Look at the last few years. We've tried to survive pandemics, politics, parenting, life. There's a lot to try to just get through, right? And to overcome. But Jesus didn't call us to just get by, to just survive. No, he gives us a mission. Go and make disciples. Go share what you have with someone else. Jesus has saved you. Others need to be saved. You know how they can be saved. It's through Jesus. Go and make disciples. Jesus then leaves the earth, right? He tells his disciples, go and make disciples. And Jesus leaves. Guess what? Who's supposed to go make disciples? Who's supposed to tell others who Jesus is and what he has done? His disciples, you and me. We're plan A, and there is no plan B. Go make disciples. But here's the problem. How do you start? And we say it every week, right? As we dismiss, go and share the good news with other people who need to hear it. Tell others about Jesus. But how many of you are ready to do that? Know how to do that? Where do you start? The concept of sharing what we have with others, for some of us, feels really intimidating. But let me share with you four easy steps to get you started, because it really isn't as complicated, I think, as we tend to make it. These four steps: plan, pray, go, say. Yeah, a little cheesy, I know, but you'll remember it. Plan, pray, go, say. Plan. Who are you going to tell about Jesus? Make a plan. Who is it? Write those names down. Write down three names, five names. 10 names. Write down who you want to share Jesus with. Could be people in your family, people at your workplace, people you go to school with, people on your sports team, people you regularly see in the favorite coffee shop you go to every day. Who do you want to share Jesus with? So write those names down. Then pray. Pray for those who you wrote down. Pray for them by name. And then go. And by going, that means intentionally spend time with those people. You can't share with someone that you don't spend time with. That's just logic, right? If I'm not with you, I can't tell you anything. So intentionally spend time with those people. Build trust with those people. Build a friendship with those people. And as you do so, pray that God would use that relationship to give you an opportunity to talk about Jesus. And then, when that opportunity arises, go for it. The final one, say something. Say something. When faith comes up, or church comes up, or when discouragement comes up, but you know where to go to when you're discouraged, whatever, when they're going through discouragement, share, say something. Plan, pray, go, say. But this final one is, I think, where we get tripped up, right? What do I say? I get the concept. Maybe you've already been praying for certain people. You really want to share with them. You've been spending time with them. But, man, they just gave me an opportunity to say something, and I don't know what to say. Well, let me give you a couple passages that I think will help you know what you are to say. The first one's in Acts 1:8. This is a similar passage to Matthew 28. Could have happened at the same time. It's just the author Luke wrote this down and Matthew wrote this part down, but together we get a bigger picture. Could happen at different times. We're not sure. But it's very similar in theme. Jesus is giving commands to his followers before he leaves. Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you. You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes, and you will be my witnesses. So what is it that we are to share? What does a witness share? You get called to the witness stand. You have to testify. You're going to be asked questions by a lawyer. And what do they ask you questions about? Something you've seen, something you heard, something you know about. They want you to talk about what you know, what you have experienced. Share what you witnessed. That's what it means to be a witness. We all have experiences with Jesus, things that Jesus has done in our lives, taught us, saved us from, delivered us out of. And those are things that can be shared. Be a witness of what you know and what you've experienced. Witnesses are not called on to talk about that which they don't know. They're called upon to talk about that which they do know. That's the whole point of being a witness. Another passage, though, 1 Peter 3:15 says this, instead, you must worship Christ as Lord of your life. And if someone asks you about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it. So first thing, you must worship Christ as Lord of your life. You're living as a disciple. You're living as a follower. You're worshiping like we just talked about. And that probably will cause people to question, hey, why do you have hope when you are going through this tough thing? Why do you go to church every Sunday instead of sleeping in and watching the football game? Hey, how come when we're going out for drinks after work, you're going to this small group thing at your church? What is that? You're going to a retreat? What is a retreat? And with who? Your church? Why are you doing that? If you're living out your faith, people are going to have questions, naturally. And when they ask, you give them a reason. You give them an answer. You explain it. Again, you're talking about that which you know. Hey, I go to church because I'm in a small group because this is what I get to experience in the small group. I'm going on this retreat because I read the Bible because it helps me in these ways. So what should you say? You tell others about your experience, about what you know. You tell them your story. And here's the cool thing. We live in a culture that says you do you and follow your truth, which means they can't say you're wrong because your story is your story. And your story includes Jesus. So by your own way of doing things, they have to listen to you because it's your story. Now, for some of you, that still seems too intimidating. And so let me give you an even simpler way. If even talking about what Jesus has done in your life at this point in your life is too intimidating, that this final way might be helpful, and that is to simply invite people to meet Jesus. In John chapter 1, verse 41, we see Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, and he meets Jesus, and then it says, he first found his own brother Simon, that's Simon Peter, and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated the Christ. And he brought Simon to Jesus. How did Simon Peter meet Jesus? His brother invited him to come meet Jesus. It's powerful. Sometimes we just need to invite others to come meet Jesus. It could be inviting him to a church service. Hey, come with me. You asked about church. Why don't you just come and see? We can talk about what happened afterwards. Maybe it's inviting them to your small group. Maybe your small group's doing a game night and you're just going to introduce them to other followers of Jesus to show them, hey, church people aren't as weird as you think. They're weird, but they're not as weird as you think. They're the normal people like all of us. Maybe it's something even more specific. We've talked about how we're starting a group called Alpha. And we actually had to push the start date back. We're going to start on January 31st. It's going to be over at Village Missions in the upstairs apartment. It's a nice, furnished, home-like setting where we'll have a meal and then have a video and share and talk about Jesus. But I want to show you just a little preview of why this is a great opportunity for you to invite someone to come and meet Jesus. So watch this.
We all have that person in our lives. That neighbor we pass by every day outside our homes. That coworker we see at the office 5 days a week. Those friends we catch up with every once in a while. People we wish could know and experience the love of God. How do we share it? Where do we even start? Deep inside, we know that it'll cost us something to open up our lives and share our faith. It takes time, vulnerability, sacrifice, the risk of rejection. But this is our call, to open our lives and to share Christ with people close to us. Because it's only through opening your life up that spaces for honest conversations are possible. Spaces where people can truly be themselves, explore the deep parts of life with people they know and trust. That's why we're running Alpha. It's a course over several weeks where you can invite your friends to explore life's biggest questions over a meal. It's a chance for you to invite that person into honest conversation about faith. Because when it's hard to find the moment, or the words, or the courage, you can simply invite. Alva, who will you invite?
So this is an opportunity just to invite someone. Here's the catch, okay? If you are already a follower of Jesus, this is not for you by yourself. Might be interesting. But if you want to see the videos, I can give you access to them online. The point of this is not for you to come and argue with people who have different beliefs. The point is for you to come bringing someone who needs to meet Jesus so they can meet Jesus. And so who are you going to bring? There are flyers for this in the seat backs in front of you, a simple way to share with someone else and give them the information. Like I said, it'll be January 31st right over here at Village Missions in the upstairs through that what looks like a house door on the second level there. We'd love for you to bring someone who needs to meet Jesus to meet Jesus. If, though, you are someone who does not yet have a relationship with Jesus and you have a lot of questions, then this would be for you and you can come on your own. But I still ask you to invite someone else. Bring a friend with you so together you can learn and hear and meet Jesus. In all of this, remember the simplicity of the message and the simplicity of our task. We're to introduce people to Jesus so they can believe by God's grace and be saved. It really is that simple. Think about Paul and Silas in Philippi. They were put in jail, and God causes an earthquake to happen, and instead of escaping and running away, they hang out there and sing hymns, and the jailer comes along, and he says this in Acts 16:30. He, the jailer, escorted them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." That's as simple as it gets. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. We're inviting people to come and meet Jesus, believe in Jesus, and when they believe in Jesus, for God to start doing a transforming work in their heart and for them to become apprentices of Jesus. And over time, they grow and learn what it means to follow Jesus in this way. So disciples worship Jesus, reproduce disciples. Next, as we reproduce, those disciples are supposed to grow. Disciples grow as disciples. We, as disciples, are to grow as disciples. A disciple is someone who follows Jesus. They believe and are saved, but from that moment on, they are to grow. That's what it says after go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always to the end of the age. That final statement's important. As we go and share, Jesus is going with us through his Spirit. We never go alone. But once a person believes in Jesus and they become saved, their discipleship begins. And that's why we use the terminology, and Scripture does as well, that they are born again. A new life has started. A new spiritual life has been born. But just like a new physical life, a baby, an infant, needs to grow to be healthy. If they don't grow, they're not healthy. So we, as spiritual infants, when we are saved, need to grow to be healthy. We can't just stay as spiritual infants. That would be unhealthy. And so how do we grow? We see a very simple process here. They're to be baptized, and then they are to be taught how to observe everything Jesus commanded. So be baptized and be taught. So first, they're to be baptized. Baptism is essential to the Christian faith. And notice who are to be baptized. Go and make disciples, baptizing them. You don't go and baptize and make disciples. Baptism is not a means of someone being saved. No, once someone has come to faith in Jesus, they have become a follower. Then they are baptized, identifying themselves with Jesus. This is what we see in the early church. The technical term is believer's baptism, meaning we baptize those who already believe. We don't baptize, as some churches and denominations do, we don't baptize babies or infants, hoping that one day that baptism will turn into something in their life. No, we baptize those who already put their faith in Jesus. But it's happened very quickly. It's a means of saying, I now believe in Jesus. I am identifying myself with Jesus. And that identification and connection with Jesus happens in a few different ways. One is that Jesus himself was baptized. That's how he started his ministry. He was baptized, and now we are commanded to be baptized like him. So we are doing what Jesus did and what Jesus has commanded us to do. But secondly, we also are identifying with Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. That's why we practice baptism by immersion, meaning we immerse people underwater. We don't sprinkle, we don't pour. We do that sometimes for specific health reasons. But generally speaking, we immerse people underwater because it is connecting us, identifying us with Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection. Because as we go under the water, it's our old dead life being buried as Jesus was buried after he died. So we're being connected with his death and burial. And as we come out of the water, it's connecting us with and identifying us with Jesus' resurrection, our new life in Christ. We have been resurrected as a new person, a new creation. And it then points towards our future physical resurrection. So death, burial, resurrection is all pictured in baptism. And so we identify ourselves with Jesus through obedience, doing what Jesus did when he was baptized. And we identify ourselves with Jesus through baptism, his death, burial, and resurrection. His death becomes our death. His burial, our burial. His resurrection, our resurrection. And all of that is pictured in baptism. And what we see throughout Scripture is that everyone who comes to faith in Jesus is baptized. There was not a category in the early church of an unbaptized believer, an unbaptized disciple. But in today's church, we run into that problem. We have people who have come to faith in Jesus, maybe have been a Christian for a long time, but have never been baptized. And why is that? It's because we have replaced, not we, our church, but the church in general have replaced baptism with other ways of identifying yourself as a Christian. Have you ever been told that to become a Christian, you have to pray the sinner's prayer? You pray these words. So confess your sin, ask for Jesus' forgiveness, ask for new life in him, and for the direction of the Holy Spirit, or whatever it is. There's different formulas for how to do it, right? And you pray the prayer, and you're in, and you're good. And then down the road, when you have learned enough, then we'll baptize you. Or maybe it's you went to some crusade or event where they wanted you to fill out a card saying, I now follow Jesus. Or I'm going to walk down the aisle and be prayed for up front while the keyboard plays over and over and over until they have enough people up front, right? Or all these different things. Does that sound familiar? And each of these things, it's later on that when you get around to it or when you learn enough, we will baptize you. But that's not what we see in Scripture at all. What we see is not pray a prayer, it's get baptized. It's not walk an aisle, it's be baptized. You're identifying yourself with Christ. In fact, remember the Philippian jailer, Acts 16? So Acts 16:31, they said, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. But then it goes on. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him along with everyone in his house. So they told him, you need to believe in Jesus. Then they started explaining who Jesus is and what he has done. Verse 33, he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds. Right away, he and his family were baptized. He brought them into his house, a meal before them, and rejoiced because he had come to believe in God with his entire household. Isn't that amazing? So the moment that marked his conversion to Christianity was baptism. It didn't save him, but it's what marked, I am now a follower, I am now a disciple of, I now belong to Jesus, and I'm identifying myself with him through baptism. So are you a disciple of Jesus? Are you a follower of Jesus? Have you been baptized? If not, there's a piece of your spiritual life that is missing. It's not something you need to do to be saved or earn favor, but it's an essential part of coming to Christ. But maybe you are someone who has not yet put your hope and faith in Jesus. You want to become a follower of Jesus, or you just simply want to know more. After the service, talk to one of our prayer team. They would love to talk with you about what it means to follow Jesus, just as Paul and Silas did with the jailer. Explain the word of the Lord to him and his household. If that's you, find one of our prayer team with the orange lanyards on their necks. They would love to talk with you and pray with you. Find one of us pastors. If you're watching online, there'll be a link that comes up in the chat window. Click that and then ask to talk to our online host. They would love to talk with you about following Jesus. Or maybe you have a lot more questions. Come to Alpha and hear more. Meet Jesus. And hopefully, at some point, you will believe and we can baptize you. If you're interested in baptism, go to our website. You will find under Next Steps Baptism, there's a short little form to fill out just to tell us a little of your background, and then we would love to talk with you about seeing you baptized here as a testimony of your faith. So first, they are baptized. Secondly, they're taught. So baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. They are to be taught. It's the job of more mature disciples to teach less mature disciples to follow all that Jesus commanded. We do this in many ways here at Grace. We have Sunday morning gatherings where we teach about what Jesus has taught and who Jesus is. We have Sunday school electives from time to time that talk about certain topics or themes or books of the Bible or things like parenting or whatever. And from time to time, we'll have those Sunday school electives. We have specific men's and women's retreats. We have a women's one-day retreat coming up. I don't remember the date, but there's information on our website. We would love for you as ladies to join with other ladies and to learn and grow as followers of Christ. We have a men's retreat coming up March 10th through the 12th up at Truck Creek Bible Camp. We're joining with two other Oregon Harbor churches, and we're going to together as men of Harbor churches here in Oregon have a speaker come out from Harbor Network from the Midwest, a speaker and a worship leader to lead us. It's going to be a great time. We also have Grace Group here where we have you join together with others to study God's Word, to pray for one another, to grow as followers of Jesus. We have our devotional books that are designed and written specifically to help you grow. personal learning, learning in groups, teaching kids. We use these books. We have one coming up that should be coming in this week. You can pre-order it on our website if you go to announcements, and then that'll take you to another page where you can click this link and register to get a book. They are $5 cash, $6 if you use credit card, but these are written by people in our church to help you study God's Word and to grow. And they'll tie into our upcoming series in the book of 1 Corinthians that will start next week. So disciples worship Jesus, reproduce disciples, grow as disciples. Next, disciples are to serve others. They're to serve others. Look again at verse 20, teaching them to observe everything I commanded. What is everything that Jesus commanded? Well, much of what Jesus talked about and commanded his followers has to do with service. One of the clear places in Scripture we see this is in John 13. Jesus is celebrating the Passover and then the first Lord's Supper with his disciples. They are in a room together, and they are having the Passover meal. And back then, you would have a low table with cushions around, and you would recline at the table. You wouldn't sit in chairs at a dining room table like we do today. And because of that, you would be leaning pretty close to the ground next to people's feet. Well, back then, there was a practice of washing people's feet at dinner parties. Why? Because they wore sandals, they didn't bathe all the time, there were dirt roads, their main means of transportation produced a certain kind of pollution that was rather nasty that you could walk through. And for all of those reasons, as you came into a dinner party, you didn't want to stink the person out next to you who's trying to enjoy a meal. And so in more wealthy households, you have a servant, the lowliest servant of the house, whose job it was when people came into a dinner party, they would wash the dirt and grime and pollution off the feet of the dinner guests. Well, with Jesus and his disciples, no one washed the disciples' feet. And so what does Jesus do? He grabs a bowl of water, he grabs a towel, he gets down on his hands and knees, and he washes his disciples' feet. And it blew their minds. No, this isn't for Jesus, our leader, to do. This is for the lowliest person to do. But here's the problem. None of the disciples wanted to admit they were the lowliest. So no one was the one who washed their feet, right? And so Jesus, the leader, gets down and washes their feet, and this is what he says afterwards, John 13, 12. When Jesus had washed their feet and put on his outer clothing, he reclined again and said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are speaking rightly, since that's what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done for you." Jesus, one with all authority in heaven and on earth, is the one who gets down on his hands and knees to wash grime off his disciples' feet. And then he says, "I did this so that you would go and do the same." We are to teach all of what Jesus commanded. Jesus commanded we serve, even in washing one another's feet. Growth results in service. The Christian life is a life of service. We are to wash feet and let others wash our feet, and both can be humiliating. I remember when I was a youth pastor at my last church, we had a student leadership team. We took them on a leadership retreat to train them and what it means to be a servant leader. And so one of the things we did is we had them wash each other's feet. And I'll tell you what, they hated it. And I'm not sure if they hated washing the other feet or having their own feet washed. I'm not sure which was worse. Because having your feet washed by someone, it is a really awkward thing. We are to be people who are both washing and being washed, serving and being served, and both are extremely difficult. And for some of you, it's easier to wash someone's feet than let your feet be washed, to admit that weakness. You need other people. For others of you, you love being served, and you have no problem letting other people do all kinds of things for you, and you need to also be intentional about serving others. We are in a served and be served kind of church, because that's what Jesus expects of his followers. Are you washing and being washed? Are you serving and being served? Finally, and all the people said amen. Finally, our last point. Disciples are to worship, grow, serve, and reproduce in community. We are to not do this alone. Let's read one more time, verses 18 through 20. It's going to be ingrained in your mind. Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always to the end of the age." All these things that we talked about today require or are enhanced by community with others. Disciples are to worship Jesus. You can certainly do this alone in your car, throw on a Chris Tomlin tape and worship. You can go out in nature and walk around and see God's creation and worship. But you miss out on so much if you only worship by yourself. Because all you have is your thoughts, your experiences, your knowledge. But when you worship with others, you have so much fuller of a picture of who God is and how God is working. You get to hear others singing truths about Jesus and have those words encourage your soul. You get to hear people talk about what God has been doing in their lives, what God has been teaching them through his word. And all of those things give you a much fuller picture of God, and therefore you're able to worship Jesus even more because of being connected with others. Disciples are to reproduce disciples. You have to interact with others to do that. At least others who don't yet know Jesus. But let me tell you, it's a whole lot easier and safer to partner up with others in the faith, to go out and share your faith with others, to have that mutual support and encouragement, to know that someone's praying for you as you have a conversation with someone. And also, it's safer because as you interact with people who don't know Christ, you're going to be exposed to certain temptations, things that they are doing or saying or prioritize that may go against your faith, and having a wingman, a wingwoman there to help you and pray for you and coach you and pull you back if you start to stray is extremely helpful. So disciples are to reproduce disciples, but do so in community. Disciples are to grow as disciples. And yes, you can grow on your own to a point, but you don't always know what you don't know. Sometimes you need someone else to point out some way that you need to grow or something that you are missing. There's something called self-deception. I can be self-deceived. And the trick is, if I'm deceived, I don't know it. And I need others to point that out. So I can only grow so far on my own. I need others around me to help me grow. And then disciples are to serve others. Tell me how you were to serve others without the others. It's in the title, serve others. We can't serve each other unless we are in community with others. It's required for service. So much of the Christian life is missing if you're not in community with other disciples, followers of Christ. And the best way to experience this is in the local church. I love this infographic that I found. It's about the biblical one another's. These are the things that we are told in Scripture that we are to do with and for one another. It requires community. We must have other people in our lives to accomplish these things. So if we are going to obey the commands of Scripture, we must do it with other people because we need others to care for. We are to live in harmony with one another, admonish one another, wash the feet of one another, belong to one another, love one another, encourage one another, greet one another. Do you get the point? All of these things require one another. It requires community. We cannot be obedient to Scripture without one another, without community of the local church. And so that's why we say we are to connect. We are to worship, connect, grow, serve, reproduce. These are the things that we need in order to live out the Christian faith. I want to close with a quote from the book Transformational Discipleship, where it says this: community is always attractive. It always grabs the heart of those who observe. Jesus promised that the world would understand the gospel because of the love and unity of believers. Christian community is a statement of the gospel in the culture. We are recognized as his, not by our cool music, programs, vision statements, facilities, or even our evangelistic zeal. We are known as his by our unity. Therefore, the end result of authentic Christian community is not community itself, but mission. Ultimately, the world surrounding the community is impacted by how God works within the community of believers. The community of the local church is how we make disciples in our community. So if you connected intentionally with the community of the local church. If you attend here, are you intentionally connecting with the community? Not just attending on Sundays, which is good, but we are not called to make attenders, we're called to make disciples. And disciples are in community with other disciples. And then we're called to go out as disciples to make disciples in our community. And so, this year, we want to be a church that's about the job of making disciples. Disciples who worship, connect, grow, serve, and reproduce. And so as we enter this new year, we ask that you join with us in this endeavor, that we would be a church filled with people who are connected together for the sake of our mission to make disciples. Will you pray with me as the worship team comes? God, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for how it gives us specific things that we are to do, ways we are to think. It tells us who we are to be. It tells us who we are in you. And so I pray, Lord, that we would be a church that is faithful to the mission you have called us to. May we be a community of disciples who make disciples in our community. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand as we continue to worship together?
My vision.
God, come. Turn this thing around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Calling on the name.
I'm calling on the name. It changes everything. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Cause all of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. God, turn it around. 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 God, turn it around.
Praying God come.
Praying God come. Turn this thing around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Calling on the name changes everything. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. All of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Lord, we thank you for just your amazing truth that you can move mountains, that, Lord, you are up to something, that you're healing, you're saving. You are at work, and so just remind us of that truth as we go into this new year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're a church about worshiping God by making disciples. Disciples who worship, connect, grow, serve, and reproduce. So as you go from this place, go, be ready to tell someone about the good news of Jesus. Be praying for those names that you thought about earlier. Write them down. Pray for them regularly. And then, as you have opportunity, be willing to share. Or invite them to come to church, to Alpha, to something, so they can meet Jesus. You are dismissed. Have a great rest of your Sunday. If you're a parent of a student, go down to our fellowship hall for the youth parent meeting. Elders, you can grab lunch, and then we'll meet in the conference room. 12:15, you are dismissed. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
You made the rain. So when it falls on me, should I complain? Or feel you're calling me, it's all on me to stay. And really catch what you're showing. It's my roots that you're growing, cause life is more than this moment.
You are the light, so when the darkness falls, the greatest heights, they never seem so tall, no, not at all, you're right. It's my roots that you're growing, don't wanna miss what you're showing.
Ain't no doubt about you, everywhere.
You are the joy, you're the smile on the face of your boy. You're the flowers at the park in Troy. Still the words in the back of our coins. Let's make some noise.
You cover me, my defender, when you're rolling up your sleeves. You're the truth that's gonna set the captive free. The only king that's ever chose to bleed. It's what I believe.
They keep trying to make your glory fade. But I ain't really sweating what they say.
Ain't no doubt about you. Everywhere that I go, you keep showing up. Lord, you make me wanna shout it. Oh, you're the goodness in my life. And I'ma tell you my truth. They make up.
I can still see sunshine above me, but I love all the ways that you love me. You're the good, you're the good, you're the goodness.
Through the good and the bad and the ugly, I can still feel the sunshine above me. Lord, I love all the ways that you love me. You're the good, you're the good, you're the goodness.
You're the good,
you're the good. You're the good, you're the good, you're the goodness. You're the good, you're the good, you're the good, you're the good, you're the good.